Hi, everyone. I wanted to welcome you to our CSO Forum. We're unhappy to be doing this virtually, but we're glad that you were able to take the time to join us. I'm Bill Hahn, and I'm the Chief Scientific Officer at Dana-Farber, and I think we have a great presentation today about pediatric cancers. Next slide. So I wanted to just give you a state of the Institute to give everybody a sense of where we are. Because of the pandemic, we had our research operation stopped for about 7 weeks, but restarted in May, and we've been able to continue and really get research moving along at a very high level, even if people have had to decrease density in their labs and wear PPE. And the protocols that we've put into place, including having masks and distancing and attestation of symptoms every day, have really been quite effective. We've had no employee-to-employee transmissions or patient-to-employee transmissions. But with the increase in infections in the community, we're going to be starting asymptomatic testing of employees later this month. But all of this is because we intend to be able to continue to care for patients safely, as well as to conduct our research. One of the things that we've done, I think that's been quite exciting that's come out of this, is that David Weinstock and Nellie Polyak, two faculty members at Dana-Farber, have started a science connection lecture series that's had speakers from all over the world. And this has really reached a national audience and has been a way for the scientific community to continue to interact with each other, even if we're not traveling to meetings. And one of the most important things, we've continued to deliver both adult and pediatric care throughout the pandemic, and our visits are now nearing pre-pandemic levels. So today, I just wanted to give you a few points about the housekeeping notes about how this is going to work. Everybody's camera and microphone are automatically turned off so that we can all hear the program. If you have questions today, we welcome and encourage you to use the Q&A icon on your screen. After the presentation, we'll have time to answer as many of these questions as we can. And we've also enabled the chat function today, which means that you can chat amongst yourselves. And since this meeting is being recorded, anything you you put in the chat will be recorded in the for the whole presentation. Something that we'd like to try to do, I've actually never seen anyone do this, but it might be a nice way to do it, is if you don't mind putting your name and where you're from in the chat, that way we can get a sense of, you know, where who's on and where they're from, since we can't see each and every one of you. So again, there'll be some question and answer after the presentation. So what I want to do now is turn to introducing our topic, which is addressing the gaps in curing childhood cancers. And I think that you know, this is critically important. We've made great strides in the care of children with cancer, but there have been, despite those successes, there have been many cancers that continue to be very challenging to treat and devastating for the patients as well as their families. And so, but what's changed, I think, over the last few years, and we'll hear about some of that today, is there are some really new insights and directions that are occurring in childhood cancers that make all of us very hopeful that there's gonna be new therapies to help our youngest patients. Next slide. So we're really fortunate today to have someone who I consider a wonderful friend, and that's Kim Stegmaier. She's a force of nature, an amazing clinician, an outstanding research scientist, and someone who's really leading the international effort to address pediatric cancers. She has a lot of titles, all of which are richly deserved. She's a professor of pediatrics at Harvard Medical School. She's the Ted Williams investigator at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and serves as the vice chair of research for pediatric oncology. She also co-directs the Pediatric Hematology Malignancies Program jointly between Boston Children's Hospital and the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. She's an institute member at the Broad Institute of MIT and Harvard, and is attending physician in pediatric oncology at both Boston Children's Hospital and Dana-Farber. Now, as you'll see, she's also a wonderful communicator. And I think one of the things that is really remarkable about Kim is that not only is she doing cutting edge research, but she's able to, as you'll see, her enthusiasm and her intensity for the work is evident. And I think she's inspired a lot of people to invest in the kind of research that and the possibilities that are possible. Next slide. And one of the things that she's a little embarrassed about, but I thought was important to point out because I think this is unique, is that Kim has been funded by the Stand Up to Cancer group based in Los Angeles. And a couple of years ago, around the time the Avengers movie was out, they did an advertising campaign to raise money for cancer research and had a whole campaign around that physician scientists like Kim were real heroes and the people who were out there saving lives. And what they did, because Kim is such a force in the community and beloved, they actually put her on an airplane. And so this is a plane that, when people were flying around, was flying around, and Kim very happily was next to Thor. But I think it's a unique thing to be able to say that your face was 15 feet tall on an airplane. And with that, I'd like to formally introduce Kim and have her give us our presentation.
So Bill, thank you. I'm thoroughly embarrassed. It was quite an experience to be involved in this project. So it's a real pleasure to be here, and thank you to Bill for that incredibly generous introduction. It certainly has been a strange 2020, I think, for all of us. But I hope I can convey to you today that we are so excited about advances in pediatric oncology and the work that's being done here at Dana-Farber and what our future holds for children with cancer. And so I always like to start by really just providing a framework for the talk and giving you a little bit of epidemiology on pediatric cancer. And so approximately 10,400 children under age 15 are diagnosed with cancer each year in the United States. And despite tremendous progress, and I'm going to tell you about that, it's always very sobering to realize that cancer is still a leading cause of death by disease in children in the age range of 1 to 15. As you see in this pie chart in dark blue, leukemia still is the leading cause of cancer in children, but brain tumors have now superseded leukemia as the leading cause of cancer-related death in children. And brain tumors compose the second leading category of cancer in children, as shown here in green. Leukemia, though, still is the second leading cause of cancer-related death in pediatric patients. And so these are survival curves, and they're looking at survival across a number of different childhood cancers from the 70s through about 2015. And what you can see is that we really have made amazing progress in treating children with cancer. This is largely through the use of combinations of older cytotoxic chemotherapy, and then in the case of solid tumors and brain tumors, the incorporation of surgery and or radiation. But you can see, as Bill alluded to, that for a number of these cancers, we really aren't doing anywhere nearly as good as we need. And I would argue our goal needs to be 100% for all of these children. And so many of us think that we've reached a cap, so to speak, in terms of how much cytotoxic chemotherapy we can use, and that we really need going forward to identify new approaches. And so one of those approaches is, of course, a topic that you've heard about before, which is the idea of targeted therapy. And back in early 2000, this notion really took off. And so I always like to start by reminding people one of the first major advances in this space was the use of the drug imatinib, its development, and then its targeting of a protein called the BCR-ABL protein. And this is very important conceptually to the work I'm going to tell you about today. So BCR-ABL is what's called a fusion oncoprotein. It's present in a type of leukemia called CML. And the way that these fusion oncoproteins develop is that in the cancer cells, there can be breaks in the chromosomes. And so you can have two chromosomes, they break, and then they come together. And in this case of BCR-ABL, what you have is the BCR gene and the ABL gene become adjacent. And then they encode for what's called a chimeric protein, where part of the sequence is encoded by BCR and part by ABL. And that fusion is only in the cancer cells. So that is not found in normal cells. And so when you have a good molecule like imatinib, it's pretty specific for the fusion. And the toxicity is much less. And so this drug, imatinib, really transformed how patients with CML are treated today. And so this was a very exciting first example of the success of targeted therapies in cancer. But of course, in order to really see this approach realized, you needed to be able to actually sequence individual patients' cancer. So back in 2008 is when the first cancer genome was sequenced. And this was in the case of an AML genome, another type of leukemia. And so now you really had the right magic. You had the ability to actually sequence individual patients' cancers. And you had this growing armamentarium of targeted therapies that were being developed by the pharmaceutical community and also by academic programs. And so then you could really conceive of this idea of taking an individual patient's tumor and looking at what are all the gene changes in that particular tumor, and then attempting to match those gene changes to targeted therapies. And this is an example that is from pediatric oncology, where there's a subset of childhood ALL, and ALL is the most common type of cancer in children. It's a type of leukemia. A very rare subset actually has that BCR-ABL gene change in that leukemia. And those children were very, very high risk. And as you can see in these survival curves, their overall survival with a bone marrow transplant was only about 40%. But now with the incorporation of imatinib into chemotherapy, these children now have an overall survival that's closer to 80%, and that's without the toxicity of a bone marrow transplant. So this drug imatinib has been transformative even for a subtype of childhood leukemia. And so a number of years ago, there were efforts underway in the United States and internationally to bring this type of approach to pediatric oncology, but it was actually first brought to children with solid tumors. And Katie Janeway at the Farber led one of these earliest efforts for children with solid tumors. But I was getting frustrated. There wasn't actually such an effort for children with leukemia. And I was very fortunate that Yana Pickman is a pediatric oncologist who is training in my lab. She now has her own lab at Dana-Farber, and she was also frustrated by this. And so we decided we were going to start a consortium and develop such a clinical genomics trial for children with leukemia. And so this is, again, based on the idea that in leukemia, we can actually pretty easily survey the cancer cells, either through a peripheral blood draw or through a bone marrow aspirate. And then we performed genomic tests on these leukemia samples, and we needed a test that would have a rapid turnaround time within a week or less. And so we were also very fortunate that in a collaboration between the Brigham and Dana-Farber, a test was developed that allowed us to look at the gene changes in 100 genes that were known to be causative in leukemia. Over time as well, there were special tests developed that allowed us to also look at these fusion genes in leukemia. And so then we could take that information and then rapidly apply it to the question of, are those gene changes suggestive of a targeted drug? And then when possible, incorporate that treatment into the child's therapy. And so in order to do this, we actually formed a consortium known as the Pediatric LEAP Consortium for Leukemia Precision-Based Therapy. And so this began, it was a bit grassroots. We invited six six institutions to come to Boston back in 2014. We met, we talked about this idea. People were very enthusiastic. With support from a number of you, we actually got this off the ground. We were then able to have enough momentum that we applied to the St. Baldrick's Foundation and were awarded a consortium grant. Our program grew from six institutions now to 15. And it's been a very, very exciting time. And so there was an enormous demand. So enrollment was very rapid. And there was such a demand that we actually expanded our program from an initial group of 100 patients now to over 200. And we're also going to seek to expand even further because the information that we're getting and the impact that we're having, we think, is very strong. And so the impact has been broad. We have had children where the genomic information actually changed their diagnosis and changed their treatment. We've had some children where the genomic information suggested that they actually had an inherited tendency to develop cancer, and that changes their long-term monitoring. And then we've had some individual children where this particular program directly impacted their clinical care and their outcome. And this is one example that I wanted to share with you. So this is a 10-year-old girl who was diagnosed at an outside hospital with B-cell ALL back in 2016. And she had standard chemotherapy, and unfortunately her leukemia relapsed. And then she got salvage chemotherapy and her leukemia relapsed. She had a bone marrow transplant and her leukemia came back. And then she even had a newer immunotherapy with CAR T cells and her leukemia came back. She came to the Farber for an evaluation and she was enrolled on our LEAP study. And she had one of these newer special fusion tests to look for gene fusions. And what she had is a very rare fusion in her leukemia, known as an RCSD1 ABL2 fusion. And you might say, well, ABL2, that kind of sounds like the ABL and BCR ABL. And in fact, ABL2 is a cousin of ABL1 and BCR ABL. And we predicted that this fusion would be responsive to the drug imatinib. And so this child, when we had this information back, she was quite sick. She had had reinduction chemotherapy that was not making her leukemia cells go away. She was in an intensive care unit at Children's and had multiple infections. And we were able, though, to start the imatinib, and she went into a complete remission. And she had a very durable, stable remission. She was able to get another transplant. She continued on her imatinib, and now this winter she'll be 2 years in a complete remission. So for this child, this approach was really life-saving. And it's not just now these 15 institutions. So we were very excited that across the country, there was increased interest in this approach for children with leukemia. And so the Leukemia Lymphoma Society is now supporting a much larger effort that's going to be taken really nationally in collaboration with Children's Oncology Group to do genomic profiling for children with AML and other high-risk leukemia, to have a master trial in place with targeted therapy arms. There's going to be more biomarker discovery and then more laboratory investigation. And so Yana Pickman is going to be leading one of the master clinical trial arms, and I am involved in leading the preclinical discovery. So this initial grassroots pilot has now led to a much larger national effort, which is really exciting. And so, as I said, this is not just the case in leukemia. Katie Janeway has been leading one of the first trials in solid tumors. And in fact, we were very fortunate that Katie helped us and advised us on our own study because she had a lot of experience with this domain in the case of solid tumors. And this is an example from Katie's work of a child, a 2.5-year-old, who had a type of pediatric cancer called a metastatic inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor. And this child also had a fusion. And this fusion involved a gene known as the ALK gene. And there have been good medicines that were developed to inhibit ALK and to specifically also inhibit ALK fusions. And one of those is a drug called crizotinib. And this child similarly had a dramatic response and went into a complete remission with the drug crizotinib. So this theme of fusions is incredibly common in pediatric cancer. And as we are learning more and more about the genomics of childhood cancer, we continue to find new fusions. And these occur across the diseases. They occur in leukemias, as you've seen. They occur in solid tumors, as the ALK example. They also occur in brain tumors. We estimate that maybe somewhere around 50% of childhood cancers at the end of the day will be demonstrated to have a fusion. And that number probably will go up as we learn more. And so this idea is so important that the Biden Cancer Moonshot Program decided actually to invest in funding research efforts on fusion oncoproteins in childhood cancer. And I think something that the Farbers should be really proud of is that out of 9 of those consortium grants, 2 of them are actually led out of Dana-Farber. And so one is focused on Ewing sarcoma, one of my lab's areas of interest. And this is being co-led also by Scott Armstrong. And then Sigal Kadosh is leading one of the center grants as well. And hers is focused on synovial sarcoma. So a lot of exciting work coming out of this consortium. And so another reason why, in addition to the fact that these fusions are very common, that the NCI through the Biden Moonshot chose to focus on fusions in pediatric cancers is that they also pose a challenge to us. So the examples that I showed you of these children having dramatic and magical responses, those involved fusions that contained a type of protein known as a kinase. Most of the fusions that we find don't actually involve that class of protein, but rather involve proteins called transcription factors. And so why is that challenging? So enzymes are very good drug targets, and kinases, which is what ABL is and ABL2 and ALK, those are enzymes. And they have structures that have pockets. And so pharmaceutical companies and chemists that work there can make molecules or drugs that fit into the pocket like a lock and key relationship. In contrast, transcription factors are proteins that bind to DNA, and they don't have nice pockets. And some of them are called disordered, meaning that their shape can actually change even in the process of binding to the DNA. So they are challenging drug targets. But many of us, including the NCI, was very excited about the possibility of new ideas in chemistry that might allow us, rather than inhibiting the activity of the target, to actually degrade the protein, to in essence blow the protein up, so to speak. And this idea really was in part sparked by work from 2 investigators here at the Dana-Farber, Bill Kalin, whom, as you know, won a Nobel Prize for actually different work, and then Ben Ebert, somebody that I would bet on has the potential to win a Nobel Prize down the road. And so what their work showed us is that a drug that had been a cancer therapy, thalidomide and lenalidomide, it was unclear, like, how do these drugs work? And what Bill and Ben figured out is the way that they work is actually by degrading targets that the cancers depend on. And some of these targets, such as IKZF1 and IKZF3, are actually transcription factors. So they're otherwise considered very difficult drug targets. So in this case, these compounds, these medicines, they bind to IKZF1 and IKZF3, and they help to recruit the cell's natural machinery to degrade proteins. So they're actually just completely degrading these essential proteins in the cancer. And so we've now, through our Moonshot grant, with help from some of the tremendous chemists at the Farber, have been developing ways now to try to actually find other drugs that degrade the pediatric cancer fusions. And so in this case, what we can do is we can take the protein that's the cancer-promoting protein in Ewing sarcoma, in this case, called the EWS-fly protein, and we can label it so that it turns green. And so you can see in this image, all of these are cells, and they're green. And they're green when the Ewing sarcoma fusion protein is present. So now what we can do is we can screen drug libraries to find drugs that make the green signal go away. And we can figure this out by using high-powered microscopes. And so many of us are very excited about the potential for this approach. So we don't like, though, to put all of our eggs in one basket. We always like to have multiple parallel approaches. And so another thing that you could imagine is saying, well, we're going to go after the fusion itself, but let's try to find other approaches to targeting these cancers. And so this is the idea of, can we find another Achilles heel, so to speak, in these pediatric cancers that have these fusions? And so we have now turned to an idea known as the cancer dependency map. And this work was really, in many ways, the brainchild of Bill Hahn. And it's the idea that what we'd like to do is really to be able to create a lookup table for all cancers. Not so different than the lookup table that your doctor uses when you have an infection, right? So you have an infection, let's say you have a staph infection. Your doctor has a table that says, okay, for staph infections in this community, what antibiotics are best for that infection? And they could go and they can just look it up. So what we'd like to do is to create such a table for cancer where we can say, okay, this is the disease type. These are all the mutations. These are the different medicines that are active against that particular cancer. And so from a lab perspective, the idea was to say, can we take cancer cell lines and then screen them very systematically with drugs and then also with what we call genetic perturbations and come up with new hypotheses about what are those cells dependent on, and can we target those key dependencies? And so the approach that Bill initiated and the Broad has been using, and we're now using on the pediatric side with the Broad and with Bill, is a technology called CRISPR-Cas9. And so the way that this works, in very simplistic Pac-Man terms, is that the Cas9 is an enzyme, and we can very specifically direct that enzyme to specific genes. And one by one, we can have that enzyme make a cut in the gene, and that leads to loss of the protein that the gene encodes for. And then we can say, well, when we delete that gene, what happens to the cells? Do they continue to grow just fine? Do some of them die, or do all of them die? And of course, we're most interested in those targets that, when deleted, lead to death of the cells. And so this effort had been ongoing under Bill's leadership and Todd Gall's leadership and others at the Broad. And we got really interested in applying this approach to pediatrics. And so we were very excited when Todd and Bill and others were interested in also working with us on a pediatric project. And so to date, we've now screened 100 pediatric cancer cell lines. This is the largest effort that we know of across the globe. The data all becomes public, and it's being mined by academics and by pharmaceutical companies. And I want to here also highlight that Nikesh Darya is a very talented pediatric oncologist who led the computational work for this project. And this project now is known as the Pediatric Dependencies Map. Just to also acknowledge, many, many people have been involved at the Broad, as well as a number of disease champions here at Dana-Farber. And so we've learned a number of really important things with this work. One is that childhood cancers have as many dependencies as adult cancers. So we're finding that they have as many targets as the adult ones do. And that's shown here. The ones in color are the pediatrics, and on the y-axis here is how many dependencies those cancers have. So you can see they're intersprinkled throughout the adult cancers. The other thing that we're finding, which is super important, is that pediatric cancers have some unique dependencies that are not seen in any adult tumors. And this is one example, which is TRIM8, which is only a dependency in Ewing sarcoma. And so there are no drugs yet that target TRIM8. And so now this is a challenge, is how do we go from this target to a drug if it's only relevant in pediatric Ewing sarcoma? And so here's where I think there's another really special thing about Dana-Farber, and that's that we have tremendous chemists. And so I'm highlighting our chemists here. We and others work with these guys all the time. My lab has collaborations with each one of these chemists. And so now working with these chemists, as well as another investigator, Ed Chichani, we now have a lead molecule that we're excited maybe is a TRIM8 inhibitor. And so I want to end with just one journey that I think really illustrates how collaborative the Farber is and how we can go from biology to chemistry to medicines for patients. So this really started back in 2010 with work from Jay Bradner, who's now president at Novartis, and Junqi, who's now running his own lab. And June is a chemist. And so they identified a new class of compounds called BET inhibitors. And these inhibitors inhibit proteins such as BRD4. And this is yet another fusion that's seen in childhood cancers. And so they developed this back in 2010. It worked beautifully in the lab against NUT carcinoma, which has this BRD4 NUT fusion. We and others found that these molecules were active in a number of pediatric cancers, but we couldn't get a molecule into the clinic. We just couldn't get traction with the many companies we talked to. And we were really fortunate that Stand Up to Cancer, in a collaboration with Bristol Myers Squibb, had a pediatric catalyst program that allowed us to access BMS's BET inhibitor. And Steve DuBois, who's an outstanding clinical investigator who heads the developmental therapeutics program in pediatrics, he's now leading this trial, and he and I are co-PIs on a grant through Stand Up to Cancer. And in 2019, we were able to bring these molecules to children for the first time. And so it's still early, but we have some examples now where children are responding. So this was a child who had this type of cancer known as NUT carcinoma with the BRD fusion and had a dramatic response. You can see kind of this white signal in the bones is much reduced after two cycles. This child came in a lot of pain and was pain-free after 2 months on the drug and was able to go take a really fun Disney cruise pre-COVID days. And this is now another recent example of a patient also with this type NUT carcinoma, terrible pain, a very similar story. And you can see this bright lesion in this vertebra is now resolved and the patient is pain-free. And we've now also just seen a first response outside of NUT carcinoma in a pediatric sarcoma. So very exciting, but early days, and we need to figure out going forward what to combine these drugs with. And so just to end, I think this is a tremendous place to work. I love what I do. I couldn't be more excited about the work in the future. And I'm so fortunate to work with so many great chemists and biologists and clinical investigators and clinicians here. I tried to highlight along the way the many, many people that we work with. I couldn't do what I do without terrific young people in my lab. I have a terrific group, our funding. And also really very importantly to thank many of you who have helped our work and the work of others at the Farber through your own fundraising efforts, through PanMass Challenge, through the Jimmy Fund Walk and other activities. We're just so grateful for all your help. So thank you very, very much.
Well, thanks, Kim. That was amazing. So I think it's time now that we can answer some questions. So if you want to put your questions in the question and answer section, that would be great. I think we have a couple questions that came in. So Kim, what would you say the biggest advance in treating Ewing sarcoma has been?
Yeah, so that's a great question. Ewing, as you saw, is one of those diseases where it's a challenge. There have been two interventions over the last several years that have made a difference for patients with localized disease. And so one was the addition of new chemotherapy drugs, so the older types of drugs, but the addition of two of those older chemotherapies to the backbone regimen that we were using. And the second is the idea of giving time-intensified chemotherapy. So instead of giving chemotherapy drugs every 3 weeks and waiting for recovery, we're giving them more frequently as long as the patient's blood counts show some signs of recovery. So those were two advances that for children with localized disease were very, very important. On the lab side, there is work from a number of programs, including our own, that has identified what we think is gonna be a new biomarker for patients with high-risk disease. So previously, we did not have any genetic markers of high-risk disease. We define high risk based on metastatic disease or non-metastatic. So we think now that we're gonna have a good biomarker that's genetic that will help us to identify high-risk patients and then to treat them with different therapies. On the lab side, the Ewing field has just exploded in terms of our understanding of that EWS5 fusion, how that fusion works, what some of the other dependencies are. And now there are a number of targeted therapy trials that are ongoing. And I'm super optimistic that we're gonna figure out how to actually target that fusion, which I think will be really important, or some of these other targets that are coming out of the DEP map, like the TRIM8 target.
So another question is, what role does genetics play in childhood cancers?
Yeah, another terrific question. So, you know, when I trained many, many years ago, shockingly a lot of years ago, we thought that pediatric cancer was not genetically inherited, right? And we even told families that you know, we really don't think that this is an inherited thing that's contributing to the cancer. We think differently about that now with our ability to actually sequence both the tumors and to also sequence the normal cells from children and adults. Our understanding of that has changed. So with the information we have now, we think at a minimum, 10% of children who have cancer have some underlying genetic predisposition to having that cancer. Some of those predispositions are very strong, like gene changes in the P53 gene, and some of those predispositions are more mild. That number is going to continue to go up as our understanding increases. So genetics plays a very important role. And we know that even when it's not inherited, right, the changes in the tumor are changes in the genes that are important in terms of the development of that tumor.
Great. So there's another question about future treatments for metastatic Ewing sarcoma. I know you talked about some of the things in development. Are there specific things that excite you about what's coming down the pike for metastatic Ewings?
Yeah, so another great question. You know, we and others have been looking at kind of what may predispose to metastasis. Are there specific gene changes or other molecular changes in the tumor? And there is one that we've been working on called STAG2, which is mutated in about 15 to 20% of Ewing tumors. And there's it's a little complicated, the science, but there's a partner to STAG2, a protein that's very similar called STAG1. And when Ewing tumors don't have any STAG2, they're very, very, very dependent on STAG1. So I think that's an exciting target that could be relevant for metastatic Ewing, as well as the non-metastatic tumors that have that STAG2 mutation. So there's not yet a good drug, but I think that's an example where that's a new target that we didn't know about 15 years ago. And there are companies now and others in academic programs that are thinking about how to target that STAG1. So I think that's one approach. I think, you know, the other is, as we said, targeting the fusion. Many of us are excited about targeting the fusion itself. And then some of these newer targets that we're seeing in the CRISPR data, I think, are also of interest. And then other folks are exploring different pathways. One that's become of interest in Ewing is called the WNT pathway. So I think we don't quite have the answer yet, but we have a number of really exciting leads.
So there's a switching gears here. There's a question about what advances have been made for osteosarcoma.
That's another really great question. So osteosarcoma has been a very, very challenging disease. And so it's very different than most of the other pediatric cancers that we treat. So, and why do I say that? So in general, pediatric cancers have relatively few mutations. And so, you know, if you compare them to adult, particularly pediatric cancers like Ewing sarcoma or malignant rhabdoid tumors or alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma or MLL leukemias have some of the fewest mutations of all cancers. Osteosarcoma is very different. Osteosarcoma has many, many different genetic events that occur in the tumors, which has, one, made it historically challenging to study, But now I think we have better inroads in really trying to figure out among what we call like a crazy genome, where there are lots and lots of changes, what are the critical changes in that genome? So I think, you know, historically, I would say that's a disease where we haven't made good progress, right? Where we're still using chemotherapy regimens from back in the 80s, right? So the way I treated children with osteosarcoma, and it's embarrassing to say, is not very different today compared to back then. With that said, I think that now as we're better understanding what are the gene changes, as we have better approaches such as the CRISPR type approaches, where even in the absence of understanding exactly all the gene changes, we might be able to pull out some new therapeutic targets. There are efforts now in immuno-oncology that have some early excitement, at least in the lab around osteosarcoma. I was just on a really exciting meeting yesterday where an idea that we've been thinking about in neuroblastoma, we think might be relevant in osteo and maybe Ewing, that involves combining a epigenetic therapy, which changes which genes are turned on and off, with an immunotherapy. So I'm hopeful that we're gonna make more progress. I'm a little embarrassed that we haven't made enough progress since the 80s. And it's a hard problem. Osteo is a hard problem.
Great. So there's a question that says, how does DFCI advocate for pediatric cancer research funding to the NCI, NIH, and I think you've been involved in that. So you're the perfect person to speak to it.
So that, I think that's also another really important question. So there are different ways. There are different ways that Dana-Farber has been involved. I'll use the Biden moonshot as one example. You know, so that program was sort of conceptually announced that there was going to be a moonshot, but exactly what that would look like at the time wasn't yet clear. And a number of pediatric oncology researchers across the country got asked to participate in a think tank to really say, like, what are the problems in pediatric oncology? What should we be focusing on with this funding? Should we be doing this? And so, for example, Scott Armstrong and I were on that Biden Moonshot committee that really helped to frame thinking about where are the roadblocks in pediatric oncology and what should the NCI be focused on funding. And so that really sparked a lot of discussion and then led ultimately to the Moonshot funding that's been dedicated to pediatrics. So it's both in the fusion oncoprotein space, but also there's a very large effort around immunotherapy for pediatric oncology that was funded through that moonshot. And so, you know, our involvement is continued. I've been chairing the steering committee for the fusion oncoprotein work, which really has, you know, continued. It's been a lot of excitement. They have continued to add to that supplemental funding. They've supported a lot of conferences that bring people together. Even we had a terrific virtual meeting. And so I think both by, you know, being present on the national committees that make decisions about funding, by having leadership roles in the active funding efforts, and really by being a voice to say, this is really important, and showing how pediatrics can also inform adult cancer. You know, I will say one of our Ewing trials right now that came out of work in the lab, it's across pediatric and adult, you know, and there have been patients who have benefited on the adult side. And so I think that's also very important and exciting.
So one sort of a similar question is, how do you think the landscape and the perspective of the pharmaceutical industry is currently with the development of drugs for pediatric patients?
So that's another really, really important question. So I'll speak to two parts to that. The first is that there was a very important act known as the RACE Act that was passed that does the following. So, you know, in the past, targeted therapies could be developed by a pharmaceutical company for an indication such as, let's say, they say, well, the compound was developed for breast cancer, or the compound was developed for prostate cancer. And the company was allowed to get a pass, so to speak, on doing that study in pediatrics, because they could say, well, you know, children don't get breast or prostate cancer. And so they didn't have to do the clinical trial in pediatrics. And so now we're looking at this differently, and as we should, right? Is not as the drug for prostate or breast, but what does the drug target, right? So, you know, if the drug was developed to target CDK4/6, yes, maybe that drug is used in breast cancer, but CDK4/6 is, and those are important proteins also in pediatric cancers. So, you know, if there's a molecule that's developed against a target that a group of pediatric oncology experts say is relevant in pediatrics, and there's good preclinical data, the companies now in a set amount of time actually need to do the study in pediatric oncology. And so what I will say is, since the announcement of that act, and that act was passed, we have had many more inquiries from pharmaceutical companies asking us to think with them about the relevance of targets against which they have drugs that are moving forward in later phase studies in adults. So I think that act has been very, very important, because it is recognizing the relevance of pediatric cancers and really ensuring that companies will do a study when it's important and relevant, right? We don't, you know, if there was a androgen receptor drug, you know, that's for prostate cancer, that's not relevant for pediatrics right now. But so that's been a very important change. I think the challenge, though, that still exists is like TRIM-8, you know, where that's a target that at least so far, right, in cancer looks like it's relevant in just Ewing. It's also probably relevant in the immune system. So it may be that there's interest beyond cancer in normal immune function and dysfunction. But for the moment in cancer, it looks like it's relevant in Ewing. It's really hard to get a pharmaceutical company interested in a new development of a drug for a cancer that affects a couple of hundred folks a year. So that's where I think we absolutely need the academic chemistry efforts, where we can at least, you know, work to get a lead compound and at least show that there's some activity with a small molecule. And then maybe you might be able to get a smaller biotech to, you know, or develop your own company around that as one of the assets within the company. So I think they're kind of two issues that are a little different, but related.
Great. So there are a couple of questions that I'm going to actually answer for Kim around colon cancer. And colon cancer is colon cancer, fortunately, is extremely uncommon in pediatric patients. But as I think some of you have pointed out, it's a growing concern in young adults and really has exploded over the last few years. We do have a very strong effort in this, a new center that's been launched, led by one of my colleagues, Kimmy Eng, who's a GI or gastrointestinal medical oncologist. And there's a concerted effort both in the care of patients who are younger with colon cancer, as well as a new effort to try to understand the science of it and do many of the kinds of things that Kim has described for pediatric cancers to start thinking about colon cancers that occur in young people. There are a lot of theories out there about why there's been a shift in the incidence, but I think it's fair to say that we still don't really know what's behind that, but it's a very important new direction. So maybe one last question, and then we have a couple things that we want to talk to you about is, there's another question about treatments for adult cancers that are being used for pediatric cancers.
So I'll answer that broadly. So, you know, I think the RACE Act, in fact, speaks to that, right? That oftentimes, most of the time, in fact, the drugs that are developed in the pharmaceutical community are developed with an adult indication in mind, and then they're eventually tested in pediatric cancer. There's one exception a couple, small number of exceptions, but one that is actually very exciting was a molecule, now a series of molecules, that target another fusion that I didn't talk about today called TRK fusions or TRK fusions. So these fusions occur both in pediatric cancers and in adult cancers. And so the first trials that were done with those inhibitors were actually done both in pediatric and in adult patients. And the responses were dramatic, like I showed you with the ABL2 fusion and the ALK fusion. And so those drugs actually were very rapidly FDA approved, both for children and for adults. And so that's an example where, you know, the compounds were really made with the target in mind, and the target occurs very clearly in both types of cancers. In other cases, the compounds tend to be developed first on the adult side and then tested in peds. And as you saw, it's a long lag. So on average, it's about 6.5 years from when these newer drugs are tested on the adult side to when they're tested in kids. So there's now a long cadre of these medicines that are being tested. So, you know, I showed you the example of BCR-ABL, right, where those compounds were first tested in adults. Now we use them in children for CML and for BCR-ABL positive ALL. You know, we're now actively testing things like venetoclax, which is FDA approved for adults with certain types of AML. We're actively testing CDK4/6 inhibitors, which are approved for adult patients with diseases like breast cancer. The BET inhibitors you saw, EZH2 inhibitors. So we're now beginning this wave of testing of these targeted drugs that were initially developed largely with adults in mind.
Great. So Kim, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy schedule to share your exciting work with us. I want to thank everyone for their questions, great questions and active participation in this. And also want to express our gratitude for those that continue to support the work of our faculty like Kim, who really, you know, can't be taking these leaps and forward in on cutting edge research without philanthropic support. Because as you know, the NIH is very conservative, and once you have proven an idea works, you can get support from the NIH, but it's really the philanthropic support that allows our faculty to take the leaps of logic and the high risk experiments that often lead to the biggest advances. So thank you so much for joining. I have one personal thing that I wanted to tell all of you that have come to CSO Forums. As everybody has experienced, this has been a challenging year. It's been a challenging year for the Institute, and we've had a number of changes. Some of you know that I was asked to take on, in an interim basis, the Chief Operating Officer role at Dana-Farber this summer. And I suppose that I haven't screwed it up. So they've asked me to continue on permanently in that role. And because it's such a big role, and I've had to make some hard choices about where I can spend my time. And since I want to continue to run my lab, I've decided that it's important for me to pass on the chief scientific officer duties to someone who could spend their full attention to it. And the reason that it was a little easier to do this is that my colleague, Kevin Haggis, who's been serving as the chief research officer, was willing to take on the role as chief scientific officer. So starting for the next CSO forum, Kevin will be the chief scientific officer. Kevin is a friend of mine. He is someone who I've known for a number of years. He works on colon cancer in his own lab, and is an incredibly fair and thoughtful partner. And I know that he'll take on the CSO role with a lot of enthusiasm, energy, and fairness. So I wanted to have Kevin be able to introduce himself to you. And so, Kevin, thank you for joining.
Oh, thanks, Bill. Good afternoon, everyone. As Bill mentioned, I've taken over the role of Chief Scientific Officer. I'm relatively new to the Dana-Farber. I started immediately pre-pandemic, January 1st, as the Chief Research Officer. But I've actually been within the Harvard Medical School system for many years. I started my own lab in 2007. As Bill mentioned, my lab works on colon cancer, and my background is in cancer genetics. And so I'm incredibly proud to have joined this the Dana-Farber. I'm excited about the opportunity of serving as the Chief Scientific Officer, and I look forward to seeing you all at the next CSO Forum. Back to you, Bill.
Well, thanks, Kevin. And again, thank you all for taking time out of your busy schedules to spend some time with us. We're all looking forward to connecting with you, and we're able to connect in person, and certainly looking forward to seeing you at the next CSO Forum. Thanks very much.